Good day, grade 11s. Welcome to this next lesson in mathematics. In this lesson, we're going to carry on looking at analytical geometry, and we're going to do a couple of more exam paper questions. And then after that, we're going to move on to functions, and we're going to we're going to move on to functions, and we're going to look at the parabola. Right, sorry, my internet was showing that it was slow, and I was trying to fix it at the same time. Apparently, I cannot multitask. Okay, so let's go on to analytical geometry. So it says a straight line AB. Okay, let's have a look at what we've got. We've got a straight line AB. Here it is. Okay. Has an equation 5y minus 3x minus 5 equals 0. Another straight line CD, okay, is drawn to intersect AB at 0.54, such that the acute angle between them is 45 degrees. Okay, now it says determine the gradient of the line CD. So they want the gradient of that line CD. Okay, so first of all, we know the equation of this. It's not in the right format, but we do. Because do you agree, if we had, we know that this is 45 degrees, right? Which means that that is 45 degrees. Do you agree? That's 45 degrees. Do you agree that this angle alpha here would be the angle of the line AB? And therefore, I could get this, which would be the gradient of line CD, because the exterior angle is the sum of the two interior opposite angles. Okay? The exterior angle is the sum of the two interior opposite angles. Another way of doing it would be a similar thing, but just a little bit different, would be that if you realize that this is the exterior angle of a triangle, then if you, and guys, if you're not sure which triangle I'm talking about this triangle here. There's a triangle. Oopsie, sorry about the squiggly line. That's my triangle, okay? And I'm saying this angle here is 45 degrees. These angles are vertically opposite, so that's also 45 degrees, okay? The angle of inclination for CD is this angle here, right? So if I work out alpha, which I can do because I can get the gradient of my line AB, and I have the 45 degrees, then I can work out the angle of inclination or the gradient of the line CD because it's a sum of these two. So that's what we're going to do. So the first thing we're going to do, the very first thing that we're going to do, is we're going to rearrange this equation for the line for AB into the format it's supposed to be. And the format it's supposed to be is y is equal to mx plus c, because it's a straight line, right? So let's do that. We've got 5y minus 3x minus 5 equals 0. So let's get everything that isn't the y onto that side. So we've got 5y is equal to 3x plus 5. Then we need to divide everything by 5. So we get y is equal to 3 over 5x plus 5 divided by 5, which obviously could be written as 3 over 5x plus 1. Not that we care, but that's 1. Why don't we care? Because we're working with the gradients now. So that's 3 over 5. So this gradient here is 3 over 5. Okay, which means we can work out alpha. So we can go tan of alpha is equal to 3 over 5. So therefore, we can get alpha is second function tan of 3 over 5. And now we need to get our calculator out. So let's go dig our calculator out. And just me, oh, I keep forgetting to do this. Properties, auto hide the taskbar. Sorry, I'm not trying to hide anything. It's just all in the way. There we go. Okay, much better. Hey, so we're gonna go clear. And then we're gonna shift tan fraction 3 over 5. Close bracket equals 30.96. Okay, and we're going to take it to two decimal places just so that we can make it accurate. So alpha is 30.96 degrees. 30.96 degrees. So do you agree that CD is going to be the angle of the inclination of CD is going to be 30.96 plus 45 degrees. Let me just check that that was 30.96. Yeah, that's fine. Just having a bit of a blonde day. So it becomes 9, 6, 5, and 4 and 3, 7. 75.96 degrees. Okay, so this angle here is 75.96 degrees. So you might think, oh, well, there you go. I'm finished the sum. No, you're not. You're not finished the sum at all. And the reason you're not finished the sum is because they didn't ask you for the angle of inclination. They asked you for the gradient. So now we need to put that into this formula. So we're going to go tan of, let's call it theta, is equal to, sorry, let's try again. Eraser. We're going to say tan of 75.96 degrees is equal to the gradient of CD. So let's get out our calculator. And what we're going to do is we're going to add 45. And then we're going to go shift tan of answer bracket equals, and we get, well, that was wrong. Okay, we weren't supposed to get shift tan. We were supposed to get tan of 75.96 close bracket equals, and that's 0.3.99999899888. So we're running it off to 4. Okay, so therefore the gradient of CD is 4. Yay. So we've got the gradient is 4. And I know I changed reds. I'm sorry about that. Okay. Now it says, hence or otherwise determine the equation of line CD. Okay. Well, the line of CD is going through 0.54, right? So we know that Y is equal to 4X plus C. We can substitute in 5 and 4 and get C. Do you agree? So we can say, well, Y is 4 equals 4 times by 5 plus C. So C is going to be 4 minus 20. So C is minus 16. Ta-da! Therefore, we can say that Y is equal to 4X minus 16. And guys, always look to see if what you're getting is looks like the right answer, okay? So if you look at it, you can see it's a very steep positive graph. So 4 is quite a hectic gradient. So yes, that works. And do you see it's cutting at minus 16? So yes, if you've got quite a steep thing and that's a 1, then yes, minus 16 is going to be down there somewhere. So that looks about right. Always look to see if what you're working out looks about right, okay? Right, now it's got this. It says the points. And I just want to change color. Let's just change color for fun. Okay, the points 2a minus 11, a plus 2, that's at a, c, which is at 4 minus 1, d, which is 4pp minus 7, are vertices of triangle ACD. And b is on minus 2, 3. Okay, whoop, yes, there's nothing there I couldn't have read. Okay, but they do say, if points a, b, and c are collinear, find the value of a. So they're saying that points A, B, and C are collinear. What does that mean? It means they're on the same line. And what does that mean to us mathematically? Mathematically, it means that their gradients have to be the same. In other words, the gradient from A to B has to be equal to the gradient from B to C, has to be equal to the gradient from A to C. It really doesn't matter which way we look at it. This is what's supposed to happen. So I'm just going to use the first two. I'm going to say the gradient of A to B has to be the gradient from B to C. So I'm going to call B the second point in this equation. So I'm going to say it's going to be, remember the gradient equation is, it's on your formula sheet, y2 minus y1 over x2 minus x1. So we're going to go M of AB is going to be 3 minus 2a, you have to be very careful. Don't make the mistake that I just did. What did I do? I used the y and then I used the x value of my first point instead of my y value. This is the x, this is the y. So it's going to go a plus 2 all over minus 2 minus 2a minus 11. And grade 11's another common error that people make is to forget to put their brackets around the second number. And if you do that, then it's going to really mess with these pluses in the brackets and it's going to end up with an incorrect answer. So you really need to be careful of that, okay? So what does that become? It becomes 3 minus a minus 2. See how that changes? over minus 2 minus 2a minus 7 months is plus 11. Okay, 3 minus 2 is just 1, so it's 1 minus a all over. This is minus 2 plus 11 is 9 minus 2a. So that's the gradient of AB. Okay, now let's do the gradient of BC. So M of BC, and I'm called this point 2 now, and I'm going to call this point 1. It really doesn't matter which order you do it in, is going to be minus 1 minus 3 over 4 minus minus 2, which is going to be minus 4 over 4 plus 2 is 6, okay, which is the same as minus 2 over 3. So that there is equal to this. So now we're going to use that to solve. So we got 1 minus a over 9 minus 2a is equal to minus 2 over 3, okay? So what are we going to do? We're just going to cross multiply. We're going to multiply that with that one and that with that one. So we end up with 3 times 1 minus a is equal to minus 2, 9 minus 2a, right? Let's multiply it out. So we get 3 minus 3a is equal to minus 18, minus 7 is minus plus 4a. It's equal to numbers to one side and the letters to the other side. So we get minus 3a minus 4a is minus 18 minus 3. So we end up with minus 7a is equal to minus 21. Therefore, a is equal to 3. Awesome. So now, what did they want? They wanted the value of a. Ta-da! A is 3. We're done. Now it says they want the equation of the line AC. They want the equation of the line AC. But do you agree that I've got points B and C on, I could find the value of A. Do you agree? I could find the value of A. Fine. Fair enough. But they say determine the equation of the line AC, but they've just said A, B, and C were collinear. So I could just use B and C to find the equation of that line. It would be the same as A. So that's what I'm going to do. I've got y is equal to mx plus b. My m I've already got. It's minus 2 over 3. So that becomes minus 2 over 3x plus c. And here's a point. It's minus 2, 3. Or I can use 4 minus 1. It makes no difference. So I'm going to say, okay, let's do this one. So I'm going to go 3 is equal to minus 2 over 3 times by minus 2 plus c. So then that becomes 3 is equal to minus 7 minus is plus 4 over 3 plus c. So c is going to be 3 minus 4 over 3, which is 3 minus 1 and a third. And we just gain to, what is that? That's also 1 and 2 thirds, I think. Let's just check it. Okay, so it becomes 3 minus 4 over 3 equals 5 and yes, 1 and 2 thirds. There you go, 1 and 2 thirds. Okay, so the answer is C is 5 over 3. Okay, or you could write it out as 1 and 2 thirds. So therefore, the equation of this line, the equation of that line, is Y is equal to minus 2 over 3X plus 5 over 3. And guys, have a look at it. That makes sense. Okay, again, negative gradient, negative graph. Good. Is it crossing above the x-axis? Yes, it is. So therefore, is that a positive value? Yes, it is. Okay, it's a good answer. We like that answer. Okay, so now let's just erase all the other stuff so that I've got space to write again. If you've been enough of my lessons, you'll have heard me ranting about the fact that I really hate the fact that there's not an option to block off and erase certain sections in one big go. You know, like you can just choose it like you do in, I don't know, other programs. And then, but not with the PowerPoint, unfortunately. Okay, I'll have to investigate that. Okay, right, so let's move on. Now it says, done that. Hence, determine the coordinates of the midpoint M of AB. So now we want the midpoint of AB. So now we do need to find the value of A. Okay, we do need, I mean, the big cap of big A. So we found out the little a was 3. So now x is going to be 2 times 3 minus 11, which is going to be 6 minus 11, which is minus 5. So that value there is minus 5. And then this one is going to be 3 plus 2, which is 5. And again, does that make sense? Is it a negative x and a positive y? Yes, it is. Now we can find the midpoint. So the midpoint is really easy. It's x2 plus x1 over 2, y2 plus y1 over 2. No, it doesn't matter if I go x1 plus x2 or y1 plus y2. We're just adding them. So it really doesn't matter which order you do it in, okay? So let's have a look at it. So we get the x value is minus 5. So we've got minus 5 minus 2 over 2. And this becomes 5 plus 3 over 2. So that becomes minus 5 minus 2 is minus 7 over 2. So we're going to leave it as minus 7 over 2. 5 plus 3 is 8 divided by 2 is 4. So that's minus 3 and a half. Okay, minus 7 over 2 is minus 3 and a half. And so it's about there and 4. About there. Okay, so there you go. That is the midpoint. We're going to call it M. Okay, midpoint M. Now it says, determine the value of P if CD is parallel to the x-axis. CD is parallel to the x-axis. Well, if that's parallel to the x-axis, do you agree the y value has to be the same? Okay, because if a line is parallel to the x-axis, the y value is the same the whole way along here. So therefore, P minus 7 has to equal to minus 1. Therefore, P is going to be minus 1 plus 7, so P is just minus plus 6. Ta-da! Okay, that wasn't so bad. Hey, okay, let's look at another example. Sure, it's actually got lots of bits. Okay, it says in the diagram, MNP are vertices of triangle MNP with N at minus 6, 12. M is a point on the y-axis. So in other words, it's zero something. We don't know what the something is. The equation of the line MN is this thing here, which we can solve for. Okay. MR equals NR. MR equals NR. Okay. And NQ is perpendicular to MP. See, this is why you read this stuff. So it gives you extra information that you need. Okay, and this is PR and NQ intersect at O. Okay, so it does actually cut at O. First of all, it says calculate the gradient of NQ. NQ. Huh? Calculate the gradient of NQ. Okay, first of all, let me just read what I'm supposed to be saying. It says in the diagram NNP, MNP are vertices of triangle MNP with N is at minus 6, 12. M is a point on this y-axis, okay. The equation of this line here, MN, is given by that. MR is equal to NR and NQ is perpendicular to MP. PR and NQ, PR and NQ intersect at O. Now it says calculate the gradient of NQ. Oh, okay, they tell you it goes through the zero line. Okay, so if it goes through the zero line, do you agree that we can have a very easy equation for this graph? Because we've got y is equal to mx plus c, but do you agree that the c is zero? So equation is y, this is for line NQ, hey? This is for line NQ. Sorry, the reason I got stuck is because I got stuck in my head the fact that this is perpendicular to MP, and I'm thinking I don't have the equation for MP, how the heck am I supposed to get the equation for MP, so I had a bit of a nervous breakdown. Then I realized that actually it's not so bad because I know that it goes through zero. Okay, so y is equal to mx because c is zero, and we have this point here, it's minus 6, 12. So we can substitute minus 6 minus 12 into here to get m. So we've got minus 12 is equal to m times minus 6. Therefore, m is going to be minus 12 divided by minus 6, which equals 2. Yay! So what is the gradient for NQ? 2. Then it says calculate the gradient of MP. Okay, now I'm getting happier because this is perpendicular, right? So what do we know? We know the gradient of NQ multiplied with the gradient of MP has to equal to minus 1. Okay, so therefore we've got 2 multiplied by the gradient of MP has to equal minus 1. Therefore, the gradient of MP is equal to minus 1/2. So therefore, that is minus 1/2. And grade 11s, I know I'm doing it the slow way to show you that way. Okay, I know it's the slow way. I know that what you can do is realize that 2 is the same as 2 over 1, and then you just tip it and put a minus in front of it. I know that, but I need to show you how to do this in case you get asked to show you're working in the exams. Now it says, calculate the angle of inclination of MP. Okay, we know the gradient is minus 1/2, right? So we know tan theta is going to be equal to minus 1/2. So theta is going to be arctan, second function tan of negative 1/2. So let's pop that into our calculator, and let's find our calculator first. So we go shift tan negative 1 over 2, close bracket, equals, and you get negative 26.56 degrees, okay? The reason it's negative is because the slope is negative, okay? But if you did this, watch, I'll show you. If you go shift tan, shift tan of 0.5, which is 1/2, bracket equals, shift tan, okay, 0.5, close bracket, equals, you'll get 26.57. So you don't really have to, the reason I did this was to show you that the minus doesn't make much of a difference to the size of the angle. What it does is indicate the direction of the slope. So don't stress about that too much, okay? So in this case, it's 26.565. We're going to round off to one decimal place because they don't ask us otherwise. So it's 26.6 degrees. So therefore, the angle of inclination is 26.6 degrees. Now it says, hence determine the equation of the line MP. You don't need the angle of inclination to find the line MP because we've got the gradient. It's minus 1/2. Okay. So we know that this MP is got a gradient of minus 1/2. Okay. We know that this is where the NM cuts the straight line. So therefore, if we find out what this point is here, do you agree I'd have a point in the gradient and therefore I could find the equation of MP? So we got given the equation of the line MN. Okay, the equation of the line MN is MN is 3x minus y plus 6 equals 0, right? So you got 3x, let's solve for y, shall we? Let's make it easier. Just do straight off, solving for y. Therefore, minus y is going to be minus 3x minus 6. Therefore, y is going to be 3x plus 6. So do you agree that that value there is 0, 6? So then it's very easy because this line MP is going to be what? It's also going to be going through 6, but it's got a gradient of minus 1/2. So therefore, that equation there is y is minus 1/2 x plus 6. So you see, you didn't need the angle of inclination. This hence was actually referring to that there. Now it says, hence determine the coordinates of P. determine the coordinates of P. Okay, so let's think about what we know about this. What have they told us? Let me just find another color pen for it. But okay, we've used the fact that we've got vertices. M is 0.6, N is minus 6.12, and we need P, right? M is a point on the y-axis. The equation of the line is equal to MR is equal to RN, okay? And NQ is perpendicular to MP, got that? And it tells you that PR intersects at O, there we go. And it tells you that NQ intersects at O, NQ intersects at O, right. Now it says they want the equation of the line MP. They want the equation of the line MP. Hence, determine the coordinates of P. Okay, so we've got the equation of that line and we've got the equation of that line. We know that one's midpoint, that doesn't help. We can get the equation of NQ, but that doesn't help either. How are we supposed to get P? P is this intersection of NQ, I mean of NP and of MP. NP and MP. Okay, so do you agree that we have got a graph that goes from NP, it goes Y is equal to MX plus C, that doesn't help at all. Because that's not gonna give me an M or a C. But if I found the value of R first, let me find the value of R first. That is the midpoint of MN, okay? MN, it says MR equals NR. So M is the midpoint of MN. So I could say that we've got this equation here, which is, no, but then you just have that point, you wouldn't have the gradient, but you have a point and you, okay, right. So you got, so let's do this. That point there would be R, is going to be, remember it's x1 plus x2 over 2, y1 plus y2 over 2. Okay, so if we do that, do you agree this is going to be 0 plus minus 6, all, I don't know what I said, over 2, and then it's going to be 6 plus minus 12 over 2. 0 minus 6 is minus 3 divided by 2, which is going to be minus 3 over 2. And 6 minus 12 is minus 6 divided by 2 is minus 3. Okay, so those are the x and y values of R. Okay, that point there is minus 3 over 2 and then minus 3. Yeah, that's right. The x value is 0, x value is minus 6, the y value is 6 minus, yeah, that's right. Okay, so that's the value of R. Now, we know that we can get the equation of this line because we know that y is equal to mx plus c, but c is 0, right? So therefore, this is y equals mx, so we can substitute these values in. So we can go minus 3 is equal to m times minus 2 over 3. To get rid of that, what do? We multiply this side here by negative 3 over 2, which means we multiply this side by negative 3 over 2. Okay, that becomes 9 over 2 is equal to m. So the gradient of this blue line is 9 over 2. So y is 9 over 2x. So do you agree we now have this line, which has the equation y is equal to minus a half x plus 6, and we have this equation, y is equal to 9 over 2 plus x, 9 over 2x, and they both meet at P. So we now can use those two formulae to solve and find the coordinates of P. Yeah, I think those questions are actually in the wrong order. Okay, so let's do that. Let's do that. That was close. Okay, so we're going to let the equations of the two lines be equal, and we're going to solve for x, and then obviously once you've solved for x, you can get y very easily. So let's not choose that color, let's go for this one. So we've got this equation here, which is y is equal to minus a half x plus 6, and we've got this equation for this line here, which is y is equal to 9 over 2x. So obviously we're going to let them be equal, so we've got minus a half x plus 6 is equal to 9 over 2x. So when we take all the x's across, we've got 6 is equal to 9 over 2x plus a half x, which becomes 10 over 2x is 6. So therefore that's 5x equals 6. So 6x is going to be 6 over 5. Okay, so that value there is x is 6 over 5. And then all we need to do is either substitute into this equation or this equation to get y. I'm going to do it into this equation. So I'm going to go y is equal to 9 over 2 times by 6 over 5. Okay, so let's go. 2 goes into 2 once, 2 goes into 6. 3 times 9 is 27 over 5. So that point there, P is, I'm going to write it over here, P is 6 over 5, 27 over 5. Sure, that's actually a very nice exam paper question, don't you think? That's a very nice question. Okay, and we're done. Yeah, we did that one. Right, finally, grade 11s, we move on to functions and we start with the parabola. And obviously what I'm going to do is I'm going to start by revising a little bit of what you should know already, and then we'll move on to stuff that you know, what you need to know from this year. So what do we know about parabolas so far? The standard form of the parabola is y is equal to ax squared plus bx plus c, where a does what? A tells you whether it's a happy graph or a sad graph. If a is greater than 0, then it's a happy graph. In other words, it's a positive graph. If a is smaller than 0, then it's a sad graph. If a equals 0, then it's a straight line. Okay, so the x squared is what makes it to be a parabola. Your c is your y-cut. Your y-cut or your y-intercept, where it's cut the y-axis, and the bx is actually your left to right shift. It's actually your left to right shift. Okay. Oh, there you go. Done all that. Now, there is an equation in the turning point formula. Y is equal to ax plus p squared plus q. Okay, and what that is that the turning point is given by minus pq. Okay, whatever this value is, you put a minus sign in front of it, you multiply by minus, but you leave that one along. And that is the coordinate of the turning point, okay? So if, for example, we get given this equation, y is equal to 2x minus 1 squared minus 18, I can already tell you that the turning point is going to be 1 minus 18. Okay, so where x is 1, y is minus 18 is going to be the turning point. Okay, let's rather do crosses. I need to. Okay, and then I'm sorry, this is going to be a very steep pointy graph because the way it's been plotted and everything. Then we need to obviously find where it cuts the x-axis. So what we can do is we're going to let y equal naught, okay? So we're going to naught is equal to 2x minus 1 squared minus 18. So if we take that across, do you agree that becomes 9? I mean, sorry, it doesn't. It becomes 18. My head's jumping a little bit ahead of my hand. What am I writing with? Is that blue or purple? So therefore it becomes 18 is equal to 2x minus 1 squared. I can divide both sides by 2. So 9 is equal to x minus 1 squared. And now I'm breaking my rule because I'm going to square it both sides. And I'll show you how this works, and then I'll go back and multiply this out and show you how it works again, okay? So if we do this, we get 3 is equal to x minus 1, or minus 3 is equal to x minus 1. In other words, I square rooted both of these things. But remember, it has to be plus or minus of that. It becomes 3 equals x minus 1, or minus 3 equals x minus 1. Therefore, x is going to equal to 4. Or minus 3 plus 1 is equal to x. Therefore, x is minus 2, right? So x is 4, and y is equal to minus 2 is where this graph cuts the x-axis. Its turning point is over here. And we need to finally find out where it cuts the y-axis, which means we need to multiply this out anyway. So y is equal to 2x minus 1 squared minus 18 becomes 2x squared minus 2x plus 1 minus 18. I've just multiplied out that bracket, which becomes 2x squared minus 4x plus 2 minus 18. Taking it over here, so it becomes y is equal to 2x squared minus 4x minus 16. So it cuts at minus 16, and like I said, it's going to be a very pointy graph, and I apologize for my really bad drawing. Told you. Okay, guys, your graph should look something a little bit more like that, or even like that. That would be nicer. Unfortunately, it's a very steep graph. Let me try once more. It's a very steep graph, and it's very difficult to draw such a steep graph on a digital pen and pad if you're not an artist, and I'm so not an artist. Let me try once more. Okay, that's not too bad, and then it looks terrible. Yeah, I give up. So I apologize. I apologize for the fact that it now looks like an icicle or something instead of a stalactite instead of a parabola. I apologize entirely. Okay. Right, now let's look at this one. And I'm going to use the other method to work out where it cuts the x-axis to show you why I did the cheaty way by just square rooting both sides. But now I'm going to show you how you should do it the long way to make sure. So first of all, do you agree that the turning points here, what's the difference? Yeah, it was minus 1 and minus 18. Yeah, it's plus 1 and minus 18. So yeah, the turning point is going to be minus 1 minus 18. So x is minus 1, y is going to be minus 18. Another sharp, steepy one. Okay, now we want to find out where it cuts the x and y axes. So what I'm going to do is get it into standard form straight away. So I'm going to go y is equal to 2 and multiply the brackets, x squared plus 2x plus 1 minus 18, which becomes 2x squared plus 4x plus 2 minus 18, which becomes 2x squared plus 4x minus 16. So therefore, that cuts at minus 16. Do you agree? Cuts at minus 16. And then we need to solve for where it cuts the x-axis. And how do we do that? We let y equal 0. We're going to let y equal 0. So we go 0 is equal to 2x squared plus 4x minus 8. Let's try again. Again, I'm going ahead of myself. Minus 16. Divide all of this by 2, your common factor of 2. We're going to definitely take out a common factor of 2. So 0 is equal to x squared plus 2x minus 8. Now we need to factorize this. Your factors of 8 are 1 and 8, 2 and 4, and that's it. And the factors of x squared are 1 and 1. The coefficient is 1, so therefore it's 1 and 1. Obviously, 1 and 8 isn't going to give you a difference of 2. But 4 and 2 are going to give you a difference of 2. So it's going to be x and a 4 and x and a 2. The minus tells you the signs have to be different. And the plus tells you that the bigger one has to have the positive. Okay. Therefore, you've got x plus 4 is equal to 0. Or x minus 2 is equal to 0. Therefore, x equals minus 4. Or x equals 2. So this time it cuts through there and it comes through minus 4. And again, nice, steep, pointy graph that Candace struggles to draw. Yeah, you see, looks terrible. Okay, that is supposed to be at the turning point. Okay, let me just try once more. I don't know what it is with these sharp, pointy graphs on the digital pen and pad. I just cannot draw them. Okay, let's try again. What about if we do it like this? Okay, that's got to go up like that. Ooh! Okay, now, It's a little bit better, you have to admit. A little bit better. Okay, fine. No longer looks like a stalactite. That looks like a stalactite. Okay, it's a bit better. Okay, so that there is your parabola using the turning point formula. Okay, so now let's talk about the effects on the graph. And guys, you really, really need to understand this and know this because they love asking it. They love saying what would happen to the equation of the graph, or what would happen, would it be moved up or down, left or right? What would happen if the different things happened? And the easiest way to do that is to understand this drawing here. And it may look a little bit complicated initially, but it's not. Okay, so let me show you how to read it. Okay, we're assuming that p is greater than 0. P is greater than 0. If p is greater than 0, do you agree that the line of symmetry, in other words, this line here, the line of symmetry is going to be negative. If P is positive, the line of symmetry is negative, okay? So that means it's going to be on this side of the y-axis always, okay? Then we say, okay, fine, if that's the case, now we look at this bit. If A is smaller than 0, if A is smaller than 0, then it's a sad graph, right? Then it's a sad graph. And then all you have to do is look at Q. Is Q going to be bigger than 0 or smaller than 0, please? Bigger than 0 or smaller than 0? Well, if it's bigger than 0, then Q is above the x-axis. And if Q is smaller than 0, then it's below the x-axis. Okay, that's how you read these things. Okay, let's look at the next one. So let's just erase all. Okay, now again, still looking at P greater than 0, which means the axis symmetry is still on the negative side of the y-axis. But this time, A is greater than 0, which means it's a happy graph. Then if Q is bigger than 0, it means it's above the line. Or if Q is smaller than that, it's below the line. Now, exactly the same thing is happening on this side, except the only difference is that this time, the axis symmetry is moved over to the positive values. In other words, on the positive side of the y-axis, but then otherwise, do you see that it's exactly the same? Okay, so do you agree that Q moves the graph up and down, P moves the graph left and right, and A makes it either a happy graph or sad graph? It also makes it a very steep graph or a shallow graph, depending on if A is big or small. If A is very big, it's a very steep graph, and if A is very small, it's a very shallow graph. Okay, so in other words, a half for A would mean it's like a very flat graph, whereas a 4 for A would be, it's a very steep graph like we just drew here, which is horrible. Okay, get it. Okay, now I'm going to stop. We're going to carry on with this on Wednesday when we have our next lesson. I hope you've learned something from this lesson, grade 11s, and hope you've had a wonderful day. And I look forward to giving you more math lessons on Wednesday. Cheers.